Let me go ahead and pray, and then I'll have a couple announcements and we'll get started, okay? Let's pray. Father, we come to you in Jesus' name, and I just want to thank you, Father, for sending your son Jesus to us to die for our sins. And Father, I thank you for showing us who you are through Jesus. Thank you for teaching us how to live through the teachings of Jesus, through looking at Jesus and the way he lives. I ask today, Father, that you cover us with your blood, well, with the blood of Jesus. And I ask that you would protect this webinar, that you would make the broadcast work perfectly, audio and video. I bind off hindrances and malfunctions from this webinar in Jesus' name. And I loose perfect function for the audio and the video and all the technology that holds us together in Jesus' name. And Father, I ask that you would show us your son, Jesus, that Holy Spirit would speak through me and through us all one to another. And that Father, you would reveal your son to us and help us to love him more. Help us to love him like you love him, Father, and to receive your love as well and the love of your spirit and the power of your spirit. Thank you, Father. We love you and bless you. We charge angels in Jesus' name to watch over this webinar and all the people who are attending it and who will watch later, and protect us, do warfare from heaven on our behalf, link arms around us, do not allow any evil thing to pass here, no noises, no distractions, no enemy attacks, but only perfect flow and protection from God will be manifest here. In Jesus' name, we thank you, Father. Amen and amen. All right, everybody, thank you so much. Again, just if you have not been on a webinar with me before, would you let me know in the chat if you say this is my first time, first webinar ever. In the chat, let me know. I recognize so many names, but okay, welcome. We do have some first timers. I'm so glad you are here. Thanks for tuning in. Okay, so a couple of announcements. Let's see here. Next Thursday at the same time will be the next webinar on Jesus, Son of God. Specifically today, we're talking about Jesus as the Son of Man, his fully human form. And then tomorrow we're talking about him as the Son of God because he was and is both fully God and fully man at the same time. And so anyway, that is next Thursday. I already sent out the registration link and I will send that out again before Thursday's webinar. So if you can go in your email and find that, you can go ahead and sign up for that. It is totally free. And then also, I released a new ebook today. Yay! The new ebook is 21 Days of Breakthrough Prayer. And that book is available. I sent out the email just a few minutes ago. It is a 21-day guided prayer journey. It is not prayers written out for you word for word, but rather prayer points, bullet point prayer lists through 21 scripture passages that are specifically about breakthrough. Okay. And we have gotten more testimonies from that prayer plan, which I released some time ago on the blog, more testimonies from that than I think from any of our other prayers, except for the justice prayer. So grab that. People have asked me for that ebook for a long, long time. And we are releasing that ebook today because we are doing fundraising for our women's retreat, training women writers and preachers. Actually, it's going to be preachers and teachers residential. The writing retreat is November 4 and 5. That is going to be online. You are going to be able to watch it from wherever you are online. But then the preaching and teaching training is going to be for women in Pigeon Forge, Tennessee, hopefully next March or April. We will not know the exact date until all the money comes in because I'm going to sign up for it after it is paid for. Okay. So that's why we are releasing ebooks. We'll be releasing more coming up soon. So thanks so much. Go grab that. And there's a 10% off coupon or 15, 10, I think, in your email. Okay. Let's talk about Jesus. So are we ready? Now, for those of you who are first time attendees, just know this, I tend to talk fast. Is that okay? That means that everybody needs to listen fast, but you will receive a video replay of this webinar about 2-3 hours usually after the class ends. The webinar software sends out a video replay automatically. Can you listen fast? If you're ready to listen fast, say yes in the chat. Yes. All right. I'm seeing some yeses. Awesome. Okay. Super. Well, we are going to get started by talking about Jesus, the Son of Man. Jesus, the Son of Man. Why is it so important that Jesus called himself the Son of Man? Any ideas? If you have ideas, go ahead and put that in the chat. I'd like to hear your thoughts on that. If you have any idea, why was it so important for Jesus to be called the Son of Man, specifically the Son of Man. Sid says he came in the flesh. Yes, and that is very important because, and Paul writes, because he was fully human and could fully identify. That's right, Paul. And Paul, by the way, it's good to see you. I've been praying for you, brother. So yes, Jesus was the Son of Man and is the Son of Man, meaning that he is both fully God and fully man. And that is important because humankind, we were the ones that sinned, okay? The Bible gives specific descriptions, like in the book of Job, saying that there are other sons of God in other places that appear before God in heaven. But the humans here on earth, we are the ones who sinned. And we are the ones whom Father God said he wanted to make in his image. And we are the ones that he found worthy, not because of our own flesh or our own worth, but because he loved us so much. So he decided that he wanted to redeem us. But mankind sinned, and therefore mankind had to pay the price. This is because God is just, okay? He is just and he is fair. Perfectly and through, just and fair. And so he could not mete out the price of sin on anyone other than a human. But he could mete out the price of sin, the wages of sin being death, the Bible tells us in Romans. He could mete that price out, that punishment out on a willing substitute. And that willing substitute had to be one of us. And so Jesus and Father God had worked this out before the foundation of the world, because the Bible tells us that Jesus is the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. So this has been their plan. And so Jesus came to earth in human form. He was actually born of Holy Spirit's sperma, or word in the Greek, which is literally sperma in the Greek as well, and Mary's egg. That's why in one of the genealogies, we read the genealogy comes down through Mary. Why? Because Mary was his only human biological ancestor. Okay? Although he had symbolic ancestors because of Mary's lineage through David, which is why he called himself the Son of David, and through the kingly line going back thousands of years, all the way to Adam, of course. But it was very important that he actually be human. And the enemy has tried to distort that truth. For example, back in Bible times and shortly thereafter, there was a thing called Gnosticism that happened. Has anyone ever heard of that? The Gnostics or Gnosticism? You might not know what it is, but just let me know if you've heard of that before. Gnosticism. And that is spelled G-N. I'll write it here in the chat. The Gnostics. So the Gnostics were a group of people who came up with the very strange theology that flesh is bad, that matter is bad, and that the only thing good in the world is spirit. And so they said that because flesh was bad in their opinion, and which is a heretical opinion, that Jesus could not have actually been flesh. He could not have actually been human because God would not have inhabited something bad in their opinion. And so they made up this lie, which was total heresy from the devil, that that Jesus must have just been like a spirit, like a ghost floating around, an illusion, like a mirage, and that he didn't actually die, since they thought he wasn't actually flesh, and therefore salvation was a myth because Jesus didn't really die, because Jesus wasn't really a person, he was just a mirage. And that's what Gnosticism was, okay? And so that's heresy. The fact of the matter is that Jesus came in very human flesh, that Mary was a virgin when she became pregnant with the sperm of the Holy Spirit, and who just simply brooded over her and deposited Jesus in her. That's what the angel said he would do. And that Mary had a very real pregnancy and a very real delivery, and the child grew and increased in wisdom and in stature and in favor with God and man. That's what we read in the Bible. So Jesus was very human. And then we have a documented very clearly that Jesus did die a terrible, gruesome death, which only would have been possible for a human, okay? No spirit would die like that. They were correct in that, but Jesus was not just a spirit. He was man, fully man. And so Jesus was the Son of Man. Now, Jesus claimed This title, though, during his ministry, he claimed the title of Son of Man. How many of you have seen the free, they're not movies, what are they, a mini series called The Chosen or Chosen? Anybody seen that? Let me know in the chat if you've seen that. It's about the life of Jesus. It's a theatrical representation, a screenplay, a series of episodes. Quite a few people have seen that. It is amazing. It is absolutely amazing. It's not scripture, of course. It's not equal with scripture, but it is an artistic portrayal of scripture that is really anointed. You should watch it. It's totally free, and you will cry, I assure you, and you will love Jesus more for having watched it. But they emphasize how human he was, you know, and they show him as having a sense of humor and making some, not sarcastic exactly, but very funny, dry humor type of comments. And I love that because Jesus was like that. And there are actually letters about Jesus, and there are historical descriptions of Jesus. And in the Bible, we even read that people were just awestruck, that there were actually the soldiers were sent after him when the Pharisees wanted to kill him. And they came back to their masters without Jesus. And they said, well, why didn't you arrest him? And the soldiers just shook their head and they said, no man ever spoke like this man. And so he was a man who the Bible tells us in Isaiah that he was not beautiful to look upon. He didn't have a model's face or a model's body. There was no beauty that we should desire him, the Bible tells us. But yet he was very personable. He was warm. He loved to hold children and to talk to people and to love on people and to take care of them. And he empathized and sympathized with them. He wept when others wept. Okay, so Jesus, he was so very personable. Well, so why was it so important, though, that he called himself the Son of Man? Well, the Pharisees got real mad when he did that. And the reason is that in the Bible, the phrase Son of Man actually came from the book of Daniel. The book of Daniel, chapter 7, verses 13 and 14. Now, remember, at that time, of course, all the Jews had was the Torah, which was Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy, the first five books of the Bible. Then they had the law and the prophets, okay? So they had the book of Daniel, but keep in mind, always remember that to them, that's all that they had, was up through the law and the prophets. They didn't have any of these writings of Paul or anything, and sometimes I think we forget that. So they always would have looked at Jesus, and they would have compared everything they saw to what was in the Old Testament, all right? So in the Old Testament, here's Daniel 7, verses 13 and 14, two verses that are so important. This is what it says. I was watching in the night visions, and behold, one like the Son of Man coming with the clouds of heaven. He came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. Now, who is the Ancient of Days? That's Father God sitting on the throne, okay? Verse 14 says, then to him, that is the Son of Man, then to him was given dominion and glory and a kingdom that all peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom the one which shall not be destroyed. So here is the Son of Man in the book of Daniel, chapter 7, and Daniel is describing this night vision he had, and he saw the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven. He's with the clouds of heaven. He saw the Son of Man coming to the Ancient of Days, Father God on the throne. He saw the Son of Man receiving all glory, dominion, and kingdom that all peoples and nations and languages should serve him, and that his was an everlasting dominion, which they knew that meant he was God. Okay, that his kingdom would never be destroyed. This was clearly something that spoke of deity, all right, of total dominance, total authority over all the heavens and the earth. And so what happened? Here's Jesus showing up in Israel in his ministry, and he outright claims to be the Son of Man. Now, people didn't just walk around claiming to be God, okay? That was what was called blasphemy, and you got stoned for that or killed in other gruesome ways. Okay, they were very particular, very specific about that. That was a sin. And of course, you can see why. I mean, it's clear that claiming to be God is definitely a sin if you're not God. And well, you'd be lying, you know. But anyway, so here comes Jesus, and he just says outright that he's the Son of Man. He calls himself the Son of Man. Thereby, because the people he was talking to knew the Torah, they knew the law and the prophets. So by claiming to be the Son of Man, he was telling them, I'm God. So they were real mad, okay? And that's just one of quite a number of things that Jesus did to actually very overtly and boldly claim to be God. But the Son of Man, so focusing again on his humanness, the Son of Man operated, oddly enough, as spirit-filled man. Jesus didn't walk around doing weird pie-in-the-sky things that only God could do. Now, it looked like it probably at that time to the people because he did miracles that they had never seen before. But you know what? For example, I have never seen someone whose arm had been amputated. I've never seen that prayed over and that grown back. But I've heard stories about that happening when other people have. So if that happens, I'm not going to be like, whoa, you know, I mean, like I'll think that's amazing. But my point is, I'm going to say, well, that's God. And God did that through people because he told us that he would do that for us when we pray. But they didn't have that paradigm. Okay. They didn't. To them, this was totally new, totally different, had never been done before. But yet Jesus was simply operating as spirit-filled man. Everything he did as spirit-filled man because he chose to put off the advantages of his deity and to operate a spirit-filled man to show us how to live. So when he did miracles, I'm going to show you this through some stories we're going to look at in a minute. When he did miracles, he operated in the gifts of the Spirit and in the power of the Holy Spirit, which is good news because it means that you and I can go out and do the exact same things because the same Holy Spirit who raised Jesus from the dead lives and dwells in you if you have given your heart to Jesus. Okay. And this is why at the end or towards the end of his ministry, Jesus was able to say to the disciples in John 14, 12 to 14, this is what he said. He said, most assuredly, I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also, and greater works than these he will do because I go to my Father. Now, why is it important that he goes to his Father? Well, he's not going to be around on the earth walking around in bodily form anymore to continue doing these greater works. But he's saying, so I'm going to go and I'm going to turn over my assignment to you as far as doing these greater works. And then he continued and said in verse 13, whatever you ask in my name, that I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. So that's a blank check. He's saying, hey, I'm checking out. I'm going to be going back to my Father. I'm going to delegate my assignment here of doing great works to you because my time for it is done. Now you're going to do the greater works. And the works are just going to keep increasing. They're going to get greater and greater. And so this is how and why we are able to carry out this assignment. You might not ever have thought of yourself before as a person capable of doing greater works, but you can. And I'm about to show you how, okay? Are you all good and you're with me so far? Does this make sense? I'm looking at the chat here. I'm seeing yeses. Okay, awesome. All right, so let's look at how you can do these greater works and operate the same way Jesus did because he operated as a spirit-filled man. You also are filled with God's Holy Spirit if you've given your life to Jesus. At the moment of your salvation, Holy Spirit came inside to live in your heart, and so did Jesus. There's a lot of teaching out there that tries to say, oh no, Jesus is only in heaven. He is not in your heart. But actually, he specifically said, I will be in you. And so although that teaching preaches well and it tries to give us some boundaries for what to think and what to believe, actually the truth is just, you know, the truth that just blows your mind proverbially. And we don't really need those boundaries. We just need to accept what Jesus said, even though it's wild and it sounds crazy. But yes, Jesus actually said, I will be in you. And so yes, Jesus lives inside you and he lives inside me. And so does Holy Spirit. And since Jesus said he'll be in the Father and the Father's in him, that means Father God even is in you because he is truly everywhere. Meditate on that a while and that will like just blow you up to a whole different level of faith. It's just awesome. Sometimes we lose the power when we try to delineate and we try to make sense of things and reason them out. Sometimes, I mean, we need to meditate on the truth, but sometimes dumbing it down to the level of our understanding is actually harmful, not helpful. Okay. So when Jesus, when he did miracles, what he did is he operated in the gifts of the Spirit, and he operated in the power of the Holy Spirit and the full power of faith. Okay. He operated also in total knowledge and trust in the goodness of God and his word. Now I'm going to say that again. When he did miracles, he operated in the gifts of the Spirit. He operated in the power of the Holy Spirit. So gifts and power. He also operated in full faith in God, trust in God's goodness, and trust in the word of God. Okay? All of these are things that you can replicate in your own life. You can live just like Jesus and become just like Jesus. We're all being transformed. You yourself right now are being transformed from glory to glory, faith to faith, and strength to strength. Okay? So let's look at a first example of this. Let's look at Mark chapter 3, 1 to 6. This is the story of the man with the withered hand. The man with the withered hand. This is Mark chapter 3, 1 through 6. Very short passage. It says this. And he entered the synagogue again, and a man was there who had a withered hand. So they watched him closely, whether he would heal him on the Sabbath so that they might accuse him. What were they going to accuse him of? This isn't the scripture, but it's work. They were going to accuse him of working on the Sabbath day, therefore sinning and breaking the Sabbath. Okay. All right, verse 3. And he said to the man who had the withered hand, step forward. Then he said to them, is it lawful on the Sabbath to do good or to do evil, to save life or to kill? I always used to wonder about that verse, just my commentary here. But what it actually means is he's calling them out. He understands, he's discerning their thoughts and the intentions of their heart. And he's saying, you know what? You're standing over there plotting to kill me. You're standing over there plotting to do evil. I'm standing here wanting to do somebody some good, to help them. And yet you're concerned about breaking the law. So he's calling them out on it. And he's saying, basically, which one is more lawful, for you to plot how to kill me on the Sabbath or for me to help somebody on the Sabbath? Does that help somebody? If anyone else had ever tuned in or wondered about that particular thing here, like, why would Jesus have said that? Jesus frequently did that. He called them out on the obvious when they weren't willing to admit it. So here's Jesus, you know, he says, is it lawful on the Sabbath to do good or to do evil, to save life or to kill? Because they were standing there trying to kill him. But they kept silent, I guess so. He embarrassed them. Not in a mean way. He's trying to convict them. But anyway, verse 5, and when he had looked around at them with anger, being grieved by the hardness of their hearts, he was sad. He wanted them to repent. He wanted them to believe in him. He said to the man, stretch out your hand. Now remember, this is the man who had the withered hand. And Jesus said to this man, stretch out your hand. And he stretched it out, and his hand was restored as whole as the other. Then the Pharisees went out and immediately plotted with the Herodians against him, how they might destroy him. Okay, so let's look at this passage. Here's Jesus. He comes up to this guy with this withered hand. The hand is like, you know, imagine, I don't know how bad it must have been, but it must have been pretty bad, all shrunken, you know, and shriveled. Jesus says, stretch out the hand, stretch out your hand. Well, why is that supernatural? I'll tell you why. It's supernatural because Jesus understands that the spoken word carries creative power. He's operating in full knowledge of the goodness of God and in faith in God and in understanding about how God works. And the Bible tells us, I believe it's in Proverbs verse 8 or chapter 18, that death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruit. Okay. And the Bible also says repeatedly, also in the book of Proverbs, that a man will eat well by the fruit of his mouth. So words carry power. That is, in fact, how God created the universe. He said, light be. If you look at the Hebrew that he actually spoke and you look at the words, he didn't say, let there be light, as if it was some kind of a wish, you know, or a proverbial hope. No, he actually commanded. He said, light be, as in light come into existence now. Light be. And so light became. He said, animals be, and animals became. He said, sky be, and sky became. And so Jesus is understanding the ways of God because he knows the person of God. He knows who God is. He studied the Torah his whole life. He knows the scriptures, the law, and the prophets. And so Jesus understands that words have power. So Jesus speaks to this guy that has the withered hand. And what does he say? He tells him to do the impossible. He tells him, stretch out your hand. Now, isn't that odd that he tells the guy who physically cannot stretch out his hand to stretch out his hand? Why does he do it? Because he knows that, imagine this is my hand, you know, and let's imagine this is the withered hand. Jesus, looking at this hand, knows that when he releases the word out of his mouth, because death and life are in the power of the tongue, he would have known that from his study of the scriptures, that when he speaks the word, stretch out your hand to this man, and the word comes out of his mouth, it actually births in this man the power to stretch out the hand. And by the stretching out, it received healing, because healing was necessary in order for it to stretch out. Okay. The whole problem with the withered hand was that it could not be stretched out. So when Jesus spoke, stretch it out now in Jesus' name, or well, that's what we would say that, but he didn't say that. He didn't say in my name, but when he spoke, stretch out your hand, just like you could speak, stretch your hand out in Jesus' name, the hand stretched out and therefore the hand was healed. Does that make sense? He operated in the knowledge of God based on the word of God from his study and his intimate relationship with God. Let me see in the chat if that makes sense. And he certainly didn't. I'm still watching the chat. I'm seeing some yeses, but I want to hear from all of you if possible. He certainly didn't do it on his own, because Jesus specifically told us in the book of John that he only said what Father said, and he only did what he saw Father doing. So this is what Father was doing also. But Jesus was just hearing the Lord, and he was operating in these principles out of his knowledge of the Lord, because this is just what the Lord was showing him. Okay? So I'm seeing yeses in the chat that makes sense. Okay, so you can do that too. The same way that Jesus said, stretch out your hand and the man received his healing, you can say to things, be, and they will be. You can say, light, be. I mean, oddly enough, this isn't a story about a physical healing, but just a fun thing. I've been working on renovating my house for quite a while, like over a year. And I do all the DIY stuff, you know, as much as I can. And one of the things I really wanted to do was to replace my light fixtures. And I just really like pretty light fixtures. And they were real ugly, the ones that were in the house from when it was built back in, you know, years and years ago. And so my husband had not been in agreement with changing out the light fixtures, because, you know, a whole house full of fixtures can be expensive. And so I was just waiting and praying and praying and waiting. And I started speaking, light fixtures be, light fixtures be, in my house. And I would speak that out over my house. And you know what happened? All of a sudden, my husband got on board and said, yeah, you know, you can get that light fixture to replace that. And he said, while you're at it, you might as well just replace all the light fixtures in the whole house. Now, this came out of nowhere. My husband and I are very opposite in personality. I'm like the free spirit, creative, wah, kind of person. And my husband is very careful and analytical and logical. And so he's not typically the type of person who would just go, wah, let's just fix all the light fixtures in the house. That's more my role, right? But suddenly, my husband just decided that, yes, that was just fine. That's what we needed to do, was replace all the light fixtures. Why? He did that because God moved in his heart, because I had been walking around the house saying, light be, light fixtures be. And so I had created the reality of my new light fixtures with my spoken word, because I understood the power of the creative word. And then I simply waited for the Lord to manifest that agreement. And you know what? Now all the light fixtures have been replaced. And so does that make sense? You can create reality with your words, because words have creative power. This is what the Bible tells us. So you can speak to someone and say, be healed in Jesus' name, and they will be healed. You can say, be comforted. You can say peace to a crying baby, peace in Jesus' name, peace, peace. And you can create that peace. I have done that so many times with my child, who's 3 now. But you can speak these things out, and you can work the same works and greater works than Jesus did using this technique of just listening to the Lord and just following him, saying peace, say be healed, say healing come in Jesus' name, deliverance come, freedom come, joy of the Lord be in Jesus' name. And you can create the result that you want to have, because life or death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruit. Does that make sense? Gwen Cooper says, rain come in the name of Jesus. Is there a drought where you are, Gwen? Or are you talking about spiritual rain? And Sandra, yes, repayment of your debts be. Yes, money be. Debts be paid off. Remember that Jesus said, I believe it's Mark 11, 22 to 24, that if you speak to this mountain and say, be thou removed and be cast into the sea, so it'll be done for you by my Father who is in heaven. Now, he didn't say if you work hard enough, even though the Bible does tell us elsewhere that we do have to work. He said, speak to it. And so Jesse Duplantis, one of the ministers I really admire, he says something about, you know, God didn't call you to labor over it or strive over it. He called you to speak to it. And we need to do that. Yes, Laura says, kitchen B, you must want to renovate your kitchen. Paul says, does not one have to know God's will first? Yes, absolutely. And God's will is clearly defined in the scriptures. So it's not anything you ever have to wonder about. Gloria saying, business capital B in Jesus' name. That's right. That is exactly. Grace, work for her husband, B in Jesus' name. Regina, vehicle B in Jesus' name. Rain be at Gwen's house in Jesus' name. Finances come forth. That's what Angela's saying. Yes. See, that's just how you get it. That's exactly right. That is how God created the world. And that is how so many miracles can and should be manifest on the earth, be in Jesus' name, if God's people stand up to take our place as the governors that he has called us and created us to be. Okay. Ann asked the question, is there a danger of getting into a spirit of manipulation if initially not in agreement with my husband, though? Ann, the only way you could get into a spirit of manipulation is if you're saying something that's not clearly outlined in the word. So you need to get a word about your desire. Like that's what I did with my light fixtures. You know, the Bible says that there is great treasure in the house of the righteous. The Bible says that anything I ask for, Jesus will do. So I had a scripture for everything I was asking about. Okay. Now, my husband, it's not like I was in rebellion or anything. My husband is simply the kind of guy who doesn't really spend a lot of time thinking about those kinds of things. To him, if there was a bare light bulb in the ceiling, he'd be happy. But the Bible says that your home should minister to you, that it should be a place of comfort and safety. And so I stood on the word of God, which then overcame my husband's hesitations. God did it, not me. I didn't even keep saying things about it to my husband. I simply created that reality by standing on the word of God. Because the Bible also says in Isaiah, it seems like it's 32:18, my people shall dwell in secure resting places. And in, I forget what it is, beautiful houses. Michael, could you look that up for us, please? Michael, who is our business manager, is helping me with the chat here. So I think it's Isaiah 32:18. Could you look that up? Let's see if it is. Okay. So anyway, Paul asks, what if one does not have the faith to believe what one is asking for, speaking out, even if one knows it's God's will? Well, Paul, faith is a choice, not a feeling. So faith means that you choose to believe that God is going, that he's a man of his word and that he does what he says he does. And if you don't believe that yet, then you simply have to choose to believe it. Faith is a choice, not a feeling. Okay. Tammy, yes, healing be in Jesus' name for your son. Total restoration be for your son and your family in Jesus' name. And Paul, the words of your mouth will also help you. And we'll talk more about how to build your faith a little later on in the class. Now, time is ticking on, so I do want to go on to the next example. Okay. Next example of Jesus operating in the gifts as spirit-filled man. Think about this. This is just, before I go on with the notes, this is coming to my head right now. One of my favorite examples is actually when Jesus is recruiting the disciples and he walks by and he sees disciples that are fishermen and they're cleaning their nets. They're actually mending their nets. They've just finished working for the night. You know, they've caught their fish or not caught their fish. And he sees them and he calls them. All right. Now think about this. What is Jesus operating in? He's operating in a word of knowledge. Words of knowledge frequently come by the Lord showing you a symbolic thing, or as a word of prophecy, the Lord showing you a symbolic thing and showing you how to interpret that. So Jesus is walking along knowing that he needs to recruit the apostles. That's what's on Father's mind. And that these apostles are going to build, he's going to use them to build the church after his resurrection and after he ascends back into heaven. And here are a couple of guys that Father highlights in his vision, in his on his walk as he's walking around looking at everything around him. A couple of guys mending nets, fishermen mending nets. Symbolically, what do fish represent? Fish represent the lost. Catching them represents evangelism. So here's Jesus seeing a couple of guys, and Holy Spirit highlights this in his mind. And here's Jesus. So he goes over to talk to these people and ends up calling them. They leave all their nets, they leave their father, and they go and they become disciples for the rest of their lives until they're martyred at the end of their lives and God used them to build the early church. Okay. Michael, I think it's Isaiah 32:18. Does that say something about dwelling in secure resting places? Let me know. Okay, but back to my notes. So here we go. Jesus, he cast out demons using his great faith. Okay, check this out, Paul. You had just mentioned this. Faith. And he obtained his faith in a certain way. I'll show you what that way is in a minute. Check this out. Matthew 17, verses 14 to 21. It says, "And he entered the synagogue again, and a man was there who had a withered hand. So they watched him closely." Whoa, wait a minute. I just read that. Sorry. Cast out demons. That's not what I meant to say. Let's go back to that scripture. I got my verse mixed up, although I think it is still in Matthew 17, but I'll just read this off of the Bible, the actual Bible. Yes. Okay. Matthew 17, 14 to 21 says this, "And when they had come to the multitude, a man came to him, kneeling down to him and saying, 'Lord, have mercy on my son, for he is an epileptic and suffers severely, for he often falls into the fire and often into the water. So I brought him to your disciples, but they could not cure him.' Then Jesus answered and said, 'O faithless and perverse generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I bear with you? Bring him here to me.' And Jesus rebuked the demon, and it came out of him, and the child was cured from that very hour. Then the disciples came to Jesus privately and said, 'Why could we not cast it out?' So Jesus said to them, 'Because of your unbelief. For assuredly I say to you, if you have faith as a mustard seed, you will say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move, and nothing will be impossible for you. However, this kind does not go out except by prayer and fasting.'" Okay, I want to dismantle a little thing that people often preach that is not even, it's just so wrong. People often tell you that this specific kind of demon won't go out of people except by prayer and fasting. There are some demons that won't go out except by prayer and fasting. Have you ever heard that? There are some demons that will not go out. Let me know in the chat if you've heard that. Some demons won't go out except by prayer and fasting. Yeah, so many people have heard that. Okay, this is so wrong. It is wrong. It is totally incorrect. Okay, why is it incorrect? Because it's a total twisting and a misinterpretation of this passage. Jesus, remember, has the name that is above every name. The name of Jesus, every knee must bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. That's in the book of Philippians. Jesus is the name that has all authority, and Jesus himself has all authority in heaven and on earth. And he has given us the authority to carry in his stead as his ambassadors on the earth. And so he has told us his name is all we need, in the name of Jesus, because all authority belongs to him. Now, when people preach or believe that certain kinds of demons only go out by prayer and fasting, you know what we've gotten over into? Works. We've gotten into, oh, the name of Jesus was not good enough for that demon. That demon didn't subject itself to the name of Jesus. You had to do some good works in order to get that demon out. You had to pray enough and you had to fast enough, and then you could have some good works and then the demon would go out. Can you see how sick that is? That is totally twisted. That is not what Jesus ever, ever, ever said. Okay? What Jesus said is that you couldn't cast the thing out because you didn't have enough faith. Other places say because of the littleness of your faith. And he says, hey, you know what? If you have faith like a mustard seed or as a mustard seed, you know what the point is about a mustard seed? It doesn't mean if you have tiny faith. A mustard seed is a tiny seed that grows into a big plant. So he's saying if your faith is as a mustard seed where it starts small, but it grows real big, then you can say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move and nothing will be impossible for you. But you know what? Then he said, however, this kind does not go out. What kind? What kind of what? This kind of faith that starts real small and grows real big does not go out, doesn't happen for you, doesn't manifest in your life except by prayer and fasting. If I didn't care about my mic, I'd drop my mic right there and walk away. It's this kind of faith. This kind of faith does not go out of you, does not form in you and go out of you to do these greater works unless you pray and fast. Why? Because faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. And when you pray, you hear. And when you fast, you consecrate yourself and you separate yourself unto God. And your faith explodes because you're staring at his face. You're absorbing his word. You're hearing him speak to you. You're praying about all of your burdens and you're seeing God move in power in answer to your prayers. Faith, this kind of faith, does not go out of you. It is not formed in you except by prayer and fasting. So you want to cast out some demons? All you need is the name of Jesus, but you need to believe what you're saying. Because if you don't believe what you're saying, which is faith in the name of Jesus, it's by his name, by faith in his name, the apostles preached, by faith in the name of Jesus. If you don't believe it, then you might try to cast the demon out and the demons might run after you and say, Paul, I know, and this other person I know, but who are you? You know, because you have to know whom you are operating on behalf of, and that is Jesus Christ, and you have to believe in his name. And once you are able to stand there in your authority and take up your authority, you cast out demons the same way Jesus did. He did it because he is Jesus. You're doing it because you believe in Jesus. And so you can say in the name of Jesus, demon leave, and it will go. And by the way, if you do that, always have ask the Holy Spirit to fill that person, because you don't want to leave them empty, because then seven demons will come back and the last state of the man will be worse than the first, according to Jesus. Okay. So Laura says, exactly, Laura, that's what I'm saying. There is no kind of demon that only subjects to fasting in the name of Jesus. No, it's just the name of Jesus through faith in his name. Okay. So mustard seed faith means that this faith starts small and it explodes into something big. Okay. No man was ever rewarded in the Bible for tiny, tiny, practically non-existent faith. They were rewarded for their great faith. Although even the smallest amount of faith can get you somewhere. Okay. It's better than no faith. But the point is your faith is supposed to start where it is with the measure of faith that God has given to every man, the Bible says. So you can't say I have no faith because God has given to every man the measure of faith. And so you start with that measure of faith and it's your job to grow it. How do you grow it? By prayer and fasting. Okay, that is what Jesus did. And so you can do the exact same thing. Jesus often spent all night in prayer to God alone up on the hills and the rocks and in the canyons and by the springs, wherever he was. You can do the exact same thing. Okay, Jesus operated as spirit-filled man. Now let's look at one more example before we have to go. I could talk about these examples all day and I really actually enjoy doing so. But let's talk about the transfiguration. Because there was a time when Jesus was up on the mount. There's actually Matthew 17 also, just before the whole example of casting out the demon and the littleness of your faith and stuff. And people say, oh, well, surely, or they might say, surely if there was something that was supernatural, that was Jesus just being God, you know, not being man at all, just being God, surely it was the transfiguration. Nope. Nope. Even the transfiguration was Jesus operating as spirit-filled man. I'm about to prove it to you. Now, are you ready? Can you say I'm ready in the chat? Say I'm ready. Okay. So here's Jesus. I'm starting to read in Matthew chapter 17, starting at verse 1. It says this, now after 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John, his brother, led them up on a high mountain by themselves, and he was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became as white as the light. And behold, Moses and Elijah appeared to them, talking with him. Then Peter answered and said to Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. Here we go. It is good for us to be here. If you wish, let us make here 3 tabernacles, 1 for you, 1 for Moses, and 1 for Elijah. While he was still speaking, you know, because Peter seemed to put his foot in his mouth several times in the Bible. And I don't know about you, but I'm thinking that probably if you see that whole scene with Jesus being transfigured, maybe you shouldn't say anything, you know, but whatever. Okay, so while he was still speaking, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them. And suddenly a voice came out of the cloud saying, this is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. Hear him. And when the disciples heard it, they fell on their faces and were greatly afraid. But Jesus came and touched them and said, arise and do not be afraid. When they had lifted up their eyes, they saw no one but Jesus only. Now, as they came down from the mountain, Jesus commanded them, saying, tell the vision to no one until the Son of Man is risen from the dead. See, he's again pointing out that he is the Son of Man. He's only human. And he is fully human. And his disciples asked him, saying, why then do the scribes say that Elijah must come first? And Jesus answered and said to them, indeed, Elijah is coming first and will restore all things. But I say to you that Elijah has come already, and they did not know him, but did to him whatever they wished. Likewise, the Son of Man is also about to suffer at their hands. Then the disciples understood that he spoke to them of John the Baptist. Okay, so the whole point in this passage is here's this radical event happening up here on the Mount of Transfiguration. And in this radical event, Jesus just suddenly is transfigured. In other words, he's just transformed in their view. His face starts shining like the sun and his clothes become as white as light. And we read in the scriptures the actual meaning of the words. It's like lightning, like his clothes became so white. It was like lightning. Okay. And of course, they're all shocked. And then this cloud descends and Father God is speaking out of the cloud. Okay. And it's visible. They can actually see this. So how many of you think, man, that sounds pretty supernatural? You know, like that's totally a God event. And yes, absolutely it is. But you know what? That same thing can happen to you. Why? Because it happened to another man in the Bible. And you know who that other man was? Anybody want to guess? Come on, hurry. We don't have much time left. Guess in the chat. Who was the other guy who also got transfigured? And there's another guy. Okay, I'm seeing some guesses about Paul. It was not Paul. Beth. Anne. That's right. It was Moses. It was Moses. Okay, so let's check out that reference. Here's Moses in Exodus 34, 29 to 35. It says this. Now, this is a scene that is described after Moses encountered God on the mountain when he said, Lord, show me your glory. And God said, I will hide you in the cleft of the rock and I'll pass by and I'll remove my hand and you'll see my back parts because no man shall see my face and live. Now, in the actual Hebrew there, he said, no unregenerate man shall see my face and live. Okay. And then Moses saw God's back parts and he eventually comes down from the mountain. And this is what happened. Exodus 34, 29 to 35. Now it was so when Moses came down from Mount Sinai and the 2 tablets of the testimony were in Moses' hand when he came down from the mountain, that Moses did not know that the skin of his face shone when he talked with him. So when Aaron and all the children of Israel saw Moses, behold, the skin of his face shone, and they were afraid to come near him. Then Moses called to them, and Aaron and all the rulers of the congregation returned to him, and Moses talked with them. Afterward, all the children of Israel came near, and he gave them as commandments all that the Lord had spoken with him on Mount Sinai. And when Moses had finished speaking with them, he put a veil on his face. But whenever Moses went in before the Lord to speak with him, he would take the veil off until he came out, and he would come out and speak to the children of Israel whatever he had been commanded. And whenever the children of Israel saw the face of Moses, that the skin of Moses' face shone, then Moses would put the veil on his face again until he went in to speak with him being the Lord. Okay, so what we have in this passage is that all of a sudden, Moses gets in this place of glory with God. He gets in this place where he's like begging God, show me your ways, show me your glory. God does. He answers his prayer, shows Moses his glory. And from then on, Moses carried his glory. There is not a record of a time when Moses got to stop this cycle, because it says here that he put the veil on his face and then he would leave that veil on until he would go in to pray. And then he would come back out. The children of Israel would see his face without the veil, that he was shining again. He'd have to put the veil back on again. And then he went in to speak with the Lord again. He'd come back out and he would be shining again. He'd have to put the veil back on. And so, so this cycle goes on, and there is not a record that it ever stopped. Okay. Remember, God himself, we read in the scriptures, God himself buried Moses when he died. What an honor is that? Like, if you pass away, for God the Father to come and dig a hole in the ground and bury your body because you're so close to him. Okay. And so, thank you, Anne. But it explains, so this explains all of our glow. Okay, because in Isaiah chapter 60, this is so important. In Isaiah chapter 60, we are actually commanded that we are all to operate in this place where we are all to be transfigured and to carry on our faces the actual glory of God. It says in Isaiah 60, 1-5, arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and deep darkness the people. But the Lord will arise over you, and his glory will be seen upon you. The Gentiles shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your rising. Lift up your eyes all around and see, they all gather together, they come to you. Your sons shall come from afar, and your daughters shall be nursed at your side. Then you shall see and become radiant, and your heart shall swell with joy, because the abundance of the sea shall be turned to you. The wealth of the Gentiles shall come to you. And in Isaiah, that passage where it says that you are to become radiant, the Hebrew, the literal meaning of the Hebrew doesn't translate very well. It actually means that you're going to sparkle and be cheerful. The light's going to play off of you like the sheen of a running stream. Okay. And it says the whole word arise means that you are, I'm sorry, the word of arise and shine, it says that you are, in arising, going to irradiate and shoot forth beams and rise as the sun. That's the literal Hebrew meaning for arise there. That the glory of the Lord will, the Lord will arise over you and his glory will be seen on you. Literally, it means to irradiate or shoot forth beams, to rise as the sun. That is exactly what happened to Moses. He drew close enough to the Lord that the Lord revealed his glory, and Moses got to carry his glory on his face, shining like that the rest of his life, to our knowledge. Okay? And that is exactly what happened to Jesus. That is exactly what happened to Jesus in the transfiguration. Now, why don't we read that Jesus had to put a veil on his face? Maybe it was simply because the people couldn't have handled seeing that. Maybe he had more work to do and he didn't want to get crucified right away before the time. And so he couldn't allow that to be seen. But Jesus was operating as spirit-filled man when he glowed with the glory of God. And when God even showed himself in a visible cloud. I don't know if you've ever read the story, but there's a guy that lived in the Welsh Revival, and he was a missionary to Africa in the early part of the 1900s. His name was Rhys Howells. You can get his book, his biography. It's by Norman Grubbs, but it's Rhys Howells' Intercessor, and you should totally read it. That book changed my life. But he was a missionary to Africa at one point, and they were seeing major revival in the place where he was ministering in Africa, and he went outside to pray, and he actually saw the cloud of the Holy Spirit descending on the mountains around him. He actually saw Holy Spirit. The Lord has actually allowed me to see Holy Spirit one time. And I'll tell you about that some other time. I don't have time right now. Okay. But here, that's just a small example of Jesus, just like two or three things out of his life where he was operating as spirit-filled man. He operated in the gifts. He operated out of intimacy with the Lord, carrying the glory of the Lord, trust in the power of the Lord, trusting in the goodness of God, because he knew God. And so he knew that he was only, he could say what God, what Father said. He could do what Father did out of intimacy and relationship, and he knew that it's not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord of hosts. And that exact same spirit, the same spirit who raised Jesus from the dead, is the same spirit who lives in you today, right now today, if you've given your life to Jesus, which means if you have chosen to believe that Jesus Christ is your Savior and died to forgive your sins, if you have chosen to make him the Lord and the boss of your life, then Holy Spirit lives in you and will do for you and through you exactly the same things that he did for and through Jesus, manifesting miracles on the earth and releasing the kingdom of God and showing people who God is and that he's a good, good father. Does that help? Now, there may be some people on this class who you have never given your life to Jesus. Maybe you haven't. And if that's the case, and Paul, I see that you wrote that book up there. Thank you very much. It is actually R-E-E-S, Reese Howells. For everybody who is wondering how to spell that, I see several writing that, R-E-E-S, Reese Howells. Yes. And so anyway, if you have not given your life to Jesus, I want you to know that he loves you. And giving him your life means that you receive forgiveness of sins because Jesus Christ died for you. And not only did he die for you, but then 3 days later, he actually got up because death could not hold him because he paid the price to die as a man. But natural law actually could not overwhelm spiritual law. Spiritual law was stronger, and spiritual law said that the innocent will not have to forever pay this price. So Jesus had never sinned ever. And so even though he was willing to take on the substitution and he died for our sins, death could not hold him in the grave because he didn't ever deserve to die. And so 3 days later, he got up. And Jesus actually said that he took his life back. The Father had given him the authority to give up his life, to die when he chose, and to pick his life back up again. And so 3 days later, he got up. And then shortly thereafter, he went back to heaven, testified to, seen in the flesh and touched by people. There were over 500 people documented that actually saw him in the flesh resurrected after he died. So Jesus Christ is alive today. He's doing well, and he arose. People actually saw him go up vertically, ascend into the clouds of heaven. Now he is sitting at the right hand of the Father. 50 days after that, God poured out his spirit on the earth to live inside the heart of every person who believed in Jesus. So if you want that for your life right now, would you just say, Jesus, be my Lord. I give you my life. I believe that you died for me and forgive my sins. Cover me, forgive me, fill me with your Holy Spirit. Be my Savior and my Lord. I yield everything to you and teach me, Lord. Take my life for yourself. I give it all to you. If you just prayed that prayer for the very first time, if you meant it for the first time, send me an email or let me know in the chat, okay? I want to know. All right. Has this webinar been helpful to you? It's been very short. I could talk about this for hours, but I promised you it'd be 1 hour. So let me know. Was this helpful? Please leave your comment over in the chat if this was helpful to you. And remember that next Thursday, same time, same place, 12:30 to 1:30, we're going to do another 1 hour of study looking at Jesus, the Son of God. Okay, Jesus, the Son of God. So today was Jesus, Son of Man. Next week, Jesus, Son of God. And then after that, the third week is Jesus, Bridegroom, King, and Judge. Okay, just staring at Jesus. So thank you so much for tuning in. I love you all. Please be sure you go and grab the new book, 21 Days of Breakthrough Prayer. This is a Kairos moment. And if you have not seen the email I sent out a couple nights ago about praying for the Archangel Michael to come from heaven and help push through your answers to prayer, go grab that email. It's incredibly important. Okay. All right. I love you all. Thank you for your testimonies. Thank you. Thank you for just being here today. Thank you for your prayers, your encouragement, your giving. I love you all. Mwah. I will see you all later. Have a great day. Bye-bye.